So we like to continue the conversation online when we get done, and sometimes that's some of the most candid conversation we have. So we're tricking you. Pretend like we're online. Still a family show, so watch your P's and Q's. But we're going to start our post show on the show, as we've been doing for the past few weeks. Something we've kind of touched on, but maybe I'll take it back to the gentleman who started our show off, and then we can branch out whomever wants to jump in. Medication. Are we over-medicated? Are we under-medicated? There are people who probably may need medication that don't, and then others might argue that we throw medication at a problem and hope it goes away.
I think there are times that both are true. I think there are a lot of people out there that aren't seeking help, that do need treatment. And treatment can come in various shapes and sizes. I mean, there's medication. We refer to psychotherapy or talk therapy. And then for people with more severe illnesses, there are even things like devices. There's now vagal nerve stimulators, deep brain stimulators for people that have refractory illness that isn't getting better. So there's a wide variety of kinds of treatments. I think there are situations where we're over-treating people, the challenge is for us as a specialty, as doctors, as a medical community, to try and hone it down and get the right people on the right treatments.
Fair. I think, as Dr. Bhattacharya mentioned, certain situations we are over-medicating. If we have dual diagnosis, usually a mental illness with a chemical dependency together, which happens quite often, 30-40%, sometimes up to 50% of our inpatients are those folks with dual diagnosis, so-called. They have a tendency for ask for more medication, and the clinicians sometimes tend to give more medication. On the other hand, I truly believe that some of our adolescents, especially when it comes to anxiety and depression, are under-medicated. There was a concern, obviously, with most of the antidepressants in adolescent population, and FDA had to put a black box with all of the antidepressants in that age group because there was a question about impulsivity and increased suicidal behavior. Now we recognize that was jumping the gun. New reports indicate that it is not as high as we think it is. The only thing is that we have to dose these medications more properly. Now, there are two peaks for suicide when it comes to the age population, age 12 to 19, and then 65 and above. If we are neglecting the treatment of that first group, 12 to 19, by under-medicating them with antidepressant, we're going to continue to see more suicides, suicide pacts, suicidal behavior, self-harm, and so on and so forth. Something that, as I mentioned, seems to be a cohort effect. We now see more of that. We didn't see that 20 years ago, self-mutilation happening to this extent that is becoming so common, unfortunately, amongst our child adolescent population.
What do you mean when you say cohort effect?
As time goes on, the nature of some of the findings in psychotic disorders change. These days, you would not probably see those severe psychotic schizophrenics that we used to see them in state facilities, institutionalized for years and years. Medications have changed the course of symptoms even, or the nature of the intensity of the psychotic disorders. That would be a cohort effect. On the other hand, now you see more anxiety disorders, more impulsive behavior. Now you have the social media aspect and its impact on the mental health of our teenagers, something that we're facing for the first time. We don't know what the impact would be. All these electronics, we have kids, we have seen that, you know, how we have to deal with those things as parents, but at the same time, as mental health clinicians, we are worried about this unforeseen situation that is happening, and it's the effect of time and technology and changing the community and society.
I think it would be hard to maybe sometimes differentiate between normal adolescent stresses and something that's more serious. I don't know.
Well, and that's why I brought up, you know, children learning coping skills, because, you know, I was on various antidepressants, and I think they can be very helpful. And yet, I got off all antidepressants, all medication altogether, and it was, you know, very strong commitment. And I went through very intensive therapy, which taught me things like to make sure that I was, you know, meditating on a regular basis, being mindful, you know, radically accepting what was going on in my life, you know, things that I could direct my mind and direct my behavior. And yet, if it was something that was in the education system where kids learn certain things like that, so like you get to a stressful situation, reach out for help, you know, have those connections.
They can identify it and help.
Yeah, and even train parents, like how do you build that connection so that, because most parents will expect that at some point their teen will probably get distant and start to retreat. So how do you maintain that connection and how do you reach out whenever you start to see signs, well, maybe my teen is in trouble. And I don't know of anybody that's really doing that. And yes, it would, it would potentially be costly, and yet, I mean, I think it would save a lot of lives and just the quality of life would be so much higher.
Are people talking about this? Do we hear this? The idea of kind of the presidential fitness standard? I'm thinking of physical fitness. Is there a push? Is this popular to talk about educating kids emotionally?
I would say so, big time. And if I can just speak for MIMH, we take this so very seriously. One of our flagship programs is called Mental Health First Aid. And this is a training that teaches the lay person how to recognize signs and symptoms of mental illness. It is clear doctor's offices are overloaded with patients, but the program in a sense is really designed to recognize a sign and a symptom. If a person is dealing with something, they're a lot more likely to tell a friend than they are even their physician. So if you're that friend and you've had this training, then you can say, you know what, this sounds like this, perhaps you need to get this help. So I think if we can encourage, and this is just one of the many trainings that are available, but if this is something that the community would like more of, MIMH can definitely be a part of making that happen because it's just that important. And this also continues the conversation, when you're having trainings such as this.
Yeah, that's amazing. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's something that I think could make such a big impact if it was more widespread. And,
sure.
In support of what you just mentioned, I have to also mention that, on one way, social media is a double-edged sword, so you see that there is an impact. But on the other hand, we see a lot of kids confide in their friends about having suicidal thoughts, and these are the friends on social media that initiate the call to 911. And police.
So there's an upside.
Yes, there's an upside to this. And I really think that it comes back to the fact that you mentioned that there is more emotional education in our adolescent population now compared to probably the last two generations.
I think part of the education is reducing the stigma so that when the stigma is decreased, then people are more prone to be able to reveal something that they would feel otherwise ashamed to admit. So if they feel comfortable with friends who do not embrace the stigma surrounding mental illness, then they would feel more open to confide in friends about their condition.
So if you have that self-awareness, that education, it doesn't matter if you're too afraid to talk about it or if you're too ashamed to talk about it.
Right.
Do you and your son have that? You mentioned that you share that you're both living with bipolar disorder. Is he able to talk to you, or are you able to talk to him
absolutely.
About this?
You'd have to see the movie, but
he's great.
He's in it. He's in it. He kind of tells his story in front of whole St. Louis area on Fox News, and that he has bipolar disorder. And I think for him, it felt very freeing that he could get it out there, and nobody had anything on him anymore because he'd put it out there. I think the biggest thing that I see working with kids is that a lot of parents have no idea if their child is suffering from mental illness or just being disrespectful. And I'm talking like the 8 to 12 year olds. Mm. And in many cases, if they're not responding to normal discipline, then that's often a sign for us that they may need to see, a psychiatrist or see somebody else.
All right.